Okay, so we are going to study about array address calculation. So before calculating the addresses in our array, we need to understand that how the addresses are stored in memory. When I say memory, I mean RAM always. Okay. So let's say you have 1D array and you have declared it like this, integer arr of 10. So the memory is allocated in RAM, but you visualize it like this, 0, 1, 2 and up to 9. This is how you visualize. At any point of time in any computer, we have RAM only in one dimensional. RAM is not two-dimensional or three-dimensional at any point of time. So let's consider that this is our RAM, and RAM can be of byte addressable or word addressable. So what I mean is, if let's say I divide this RAM into multiple, let's say, blocks, and this one block is of 1 byte. This is of, let's say, 1 byte each. These bytes will have some addresses. For example, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on. Obviously, these addresses will be in binary. When I write 5, that its equivalent is 101 only. Okay. So now, what I mean is, let's say our RAM is of 8 bytes. If our RAM is of 8 bytes, so in order to map these 8 bytes, I need 3 bits. I need 3 bits. Because from 0 to 7, how I will store? For 0, I can store in 1 bit also. For 1, I can store in 1 bit also, but when I come to 2, I need more bits. For 2, I need 2 bits at least, because in 1 bit, I cannot store 2. Similarly, for 3, I can store in 2 bits, but for 4, I need 3 bits. I cannot store 4 in 2 bits or 1 bit. That is 100. And similarly, 5 and let's say 6 and 7, this is like this. So when my 7 is stored in 3 bits, I have to store all the addresses in 3 bits only. So for 0, I will store 000, 001 and 010 like this. Similarly, if my RAM is of, let's say, 30 or maybe not 30, let's say 4 GB. If my RAM is of 4 GB, so what it means is 4 into 2 to the power 30 bytes. And if one address is for 1 byte, and let's say my RAM is byte addressable. So byte addressable means when I try to read or write, I can read or write 1 byte at a time. Sometimes it also referred as one word equal to, let's say, 4 bytes. And we can say that our RAM is word addressable. Word addressable. It means that in one read or write operation, I can read 4 bytes or I can write 4 bytes if my one word is equal to 4 bytes. If one word equal to 8 bytes, then my RAM is word addressable, then I can read or write 8 bytes at a time. See, whatever I am teaching will make sense. Just try to pay attention what I am concentrating right now. Why I am concentrating on word addressable, it will all make sense. Just wait for some time. Okay, so let's say one word equal to 4 bytes, then we can read or write 4 bytes at a time. If one word is 8 bytes, then I can read 8 bytes at a time. In one read operation, I can read 8 bytes. That is the meaning. Okay. Now, If this is 4 into 2 to the power 30 bytes and my RAM is byte addressable, I can write this as 2 to the power 32 bytes also. So if it was 8 bytes, that is 2 to the power 3 bytes, I need 3 bits in order to map the addresses. I need 3 bits when my RAM was 8 bytes, because 2 to the power n, and what is n? The number of bits required for the address. Similarly, for 2 to the power 32 bytes, I need 32 bits address, 32 bits of address, because what will happen? 0, 1, 2 and up to 2 to the power 32 minus 1, these are the addresses which I need to have. Why this minus 1 comes? Because we are starting from 0, not from 1. That's why this minus 1 comes into picture. Okay, so that's why, that is the reason, when you find the address of any type of pointer, if you declare character asterisk ptr, or you declare integer asterisk ptr1, so the size of this ptr or ptr1 remains same, because they are all holding address, and address is fixed. In this case, address is of 32 bits. So whether the address is of character type or integer type or double type or any type, the size of pointer will remain same. This is the reason for it. Okay. Now, when you try to store this array, the array we have declared is 10 size and of integer type. When we store this in our RAM, how it is stored? So let's say the starting address is, let's say, 300. Starting address is, let's say, 300. So my RAM is like this, and let's say this is byte addressable. Byte addressable, that means one byte at a time. Let's say this is 0, 1, and somewhere here I have 300 address, and so on. So in 300, I will have one byte. At 301, I will have another one byte, then another one byte, and another 303, one byte. So for storing ARR of 0, that is only one index, it will be stored in these 4 bytes, because integer is of 4 bytes. That's why it will take 4 bytes like this. And then this is, let's say, ARR of 0. And then from 304 to 307, it will again store another index, that is ARR of 1. And so on. This is how my whole array will be stored. This is the case of 1D array. If you remember, when we have talked about time complexity, we have said that in order to access any particular index of array, we only need constant time. If we wanted to access ARR of 1, or we wanted to access ARR of 100, it will take exactly the same amount of time, constant time, because the address calculation will be constant. How the address will be calculated? See this. How the addresses will be calculated? Now, let's say my array is this. Okay. So, let's say this is our array of size 1000. ARR of 1000, and I wanted to access ARR of, let's say, 100. So how the address will be calculated? The base address is stored somewhere in ARR. How? That, let's say, this is our RAM and this is our 300 address, and this is starting from 300. So this A300 is stored in ARR. So my base address plus how many indices I wanted to jump? let's say if I wanted to go on the first index, then I wanted to skip one index only. If I wanted to go, let's say, fifth index, then how many indexes I have to jump? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So whatever the number I want to go, I want to jump those many indices. If I wanted to go on the 0th index, then I have to jump 0 indices. Simple. So the base address plus this is stored in I. In programming format, we generally use I. Okay. So what will happen? I, this is my number of indices I wanted to jump. Multiply with size of element. Let's say if we have integer type of elements, then size of integer, because this first index is at 300, then second index will be at 304. That's what we have seen here. See, because the first index is taking 4 bytes. If my array was of character type, then it will not take 4 bytes. It will take 1 byte only, and the second index will come at 301. If 0th index at 300, then first index will be at 301, second index will be at 302, and so on. So that's why instead of writing 4 here, I have written size of integer. Why? Because if my architecture is older one, where size of integer is 2, then I have to write 2 here. If I use the newer architecture and my size of integer is 4, then I have to write 4 here. If I use the most advanced architectures, then size of integer could be 8 byte also, and I have to write 8 here. So do I need to change the size of integer in code depending on the architecture I use? No. So instead of using 2, 4, 8, I use this size of integer int, because it will calculate 2 or 4 or 8 automatically. So now let's say this is my 300 and I wanted to access, let's say, 5, ARR of 5, then 300 plus 5 into 4, and it will give me 320. And now you can see here, the second index will be at 308, the third index will be starting from 312, fourth will be 316, and fifth will be from 320. And this is what we have got, 320. So no matter what is the value of I, what you have to do is you have to just add the base address with I multiply by size of integer or size of data type. So if I is 10 or 100 or anything, this operation will take same amount of time. What? How do we calculate time? So this exact details you will study in the computer organization or computer architecture subject, probably in your fourth semester. I'm just trying to give you a simple idea. For example, for addition, my computer take 4 clock cycles. For multiplication, my computer take, let's say, 6 clock cycles. Okay. So here what we are doing is, first of all, we are multiplying and then we are adding. So probably it will take 10 clock cycles for the whole instruction to calculate. Okay. Now, if I value is 10 or 100 or anything, the number of cycles will be 10 only. That's why it is constant. And we can move to any index in constant time. And this is how you can calculate the address of any index. And if you wanted to calculate the address of 100, just do 300 plus 100 into 4. And you will get 700 as the address. This is what we have done in 1D, and probably you might have already known it. Let's talk about 2D array now. In 2D array, our array is stored in two forms. One is row major form. What is row major form? The rows are stored first. Let's say my array is integer arr of size, let's say 5 cross 5. This is my array. So how this array we visualize ourselves is, this is not the way computer store the array, this is the way we visualize it. So we have 5 number of rows and 5 number of columns. And this is 00, 01, 02, 03, 04. Likewise, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. And similarly, 20, 30, 40. And this will be 44. This is how the numbers will be, indices will be calculated. And let's say the starting address of this is again 300. If we are talking about row major form, then in RAM, remember the RAM is still 1D only, okay. And now instead of using byte addressable, let me take word addressable, and my one word is 4 bytes, for example. So in one block I can store the entire index or entire variable, okay. So what will happen, let's say this is my one word. So please, if you don't understand this word addressable or byte addressable thing, you can ignore for now, because this is little higher concept which you will come across in computer organization subject in your fourth semester. If you are understanding, that is very good, okay. So we have different memory mapping techniques, like we have direct memory mapping, we have set associative, we have fully associative, and on the basis of different mapping techniques we have different calculation of addresses, okay. So let's not talk about that. But if it is word addressable and one word is 4 bytes, then this is 0, the next address will be 4, the next address will be 8, because inside each byte has to be mapped. And for every byte, the address will be there. Okay, it's just that you have done like this. You have just mapped these 4 bytes as one word. How does it make difference? The address will be provided to each byte only. But when you try to read and write, you can read 4 bytes at a time. Instead of one byte, in case of word byte addressable, you can read or write 4 bytes at a time, because you are doing word addressable and one word is 4 bytes. What it takes to read 4 bytes instead of 1 byte? Your bus size through which the data will travel will be larger. The decoder which you use in the RAM will be larger. Okay, so that hardware will get increased. Instead of one line, you have 4 lines. Okay, instead of decoder of size, let's say 2 cross 4, you will have 4 cross 16. Okay, what is decoder? You will study in your digital logic in this semester only, if not studied already. Okay, so here the addresses will be 0, 1, 2, 3, and then 4, then 5, 6, 7, 8, and similarly. Just that the whole word will be read. Now, if my address is 300, starting address is 300, and let's say we have stored arr of 0 and 0 here. In row major form, first you have to store the first row. So this row will be stored first. So after 00, you have to store what? 01, then 02, then 03, then 04. And after this one row is finished, you will come to the next row. That is 10, then 11, then 12, then 13, then 14. After the second row is finished, you will come to the third row. That is 20, then 21, then 22. This is how the addresses will be, the elements will be stored in RAM if we use row major form. Our C language uses row major format. Okay. If it is column major, let's say if I talk about second one is column major, column measure form. So in column measure, our RAM store addresses like this. First of all, instead of storing whole row, it will store one column first. So starting from 00 only, but instead of storing 01 next, it will store 10. So it will store this whole column first and then it will move to the second column. So how? 00, then 10, then 20, then 30, then 40. Then after 40, we will go back to 01. So here we will store 01, then 11, then 21, then 31, then 41. After storing this, this will be 1, this will be 21, 31, 41. After storing 41, we will go back to 02. And here we will store 02. Okay, this is the difference between row measure and column measure. Now understand why we have studied this row measure and column measure. Now let me try to calculate the address of 10 here and 10 in this form. What is the difference? If we try to calculate the address, let's say this is 300, then this will be 304, this will be 308, this will be 312, 316, and this is 320. Here the address is 320, whereas here if it is 300, then it will be 304. The addresses are different. For the same index, the addresses are different. How does it make difference if the addresses are different? Now here comes the advanced thing. Please understand if you can. If my word, one word is 8 bytes, if my one word is 8 bytes, then what it means is I can read 2 integer type elements at one time. Because one integer is 4 bytes, I can read 8 bytes at a time. So it means 2 integer elements at a time. Now if I try to access A00, it will take one read cycle, and with 00, 01 will come free of cost. See, if one read operation takes 1 millisecond, for example, so if I wanted to read 00, and because in one read operation I can read 8 bytes, that's why this 01 will come free of cost. So if I wanted to access 00 and 01, it will come 1 millisecond, and this is 0 millisecond, which is free of cost. So in order to access these two indices, I will take 1 millisecond only. But in this case, if I wanted to access 00 and 01, here this will come 1 millisecond, but with 00, 10 will come free of cost, not 01. What will come free of cost? 10, not 01. So for 00, you have to spend 1 millisecond. And for 01, because it is somewhere down, you have to access one more time because it is not coming free of cost. So you will spend 1 more millisecond. So in this case, in order to access 2 elements, you will take 2 milliseconds. Understood? This is the difference. Now, is it making sense that row measure is more beneficial than column measure? No. Why? Because let's say I wanted to access 00 and 10 in row measure form. So 00 will take 1 millisecond and 10 is not coming free. What is coming free is 01. So again, in order to access 10, which is down the line in the RAM, it will again take 1 millisecond. So here in row measure, if I wanted to access these two elements, it is taking 2 milliseconds. Whereas if I move to column measure, then 00 and 10, this is taking 1 millisecond, and along with 00, 10 is coming free of cost. So I don't have to spend any time for it. So this will take 0 millisecond, and here it will take total 1 millisecond. So it depends on what type of elements you wanted to access. On the basis of it, the time will be smaller or larger. So row major or column major, both are beneficial and both can have disadvantages also. Now let's try to calculate the addresses in both the forms, in row major also and column major also. So let's try to make one 2D array. Let's say I have created a 2D array of size 10 cross, let's say 10. This is square matrix. Even if you don't make square matrix, then also we can calculate the addresses. That is not a problem. But let's take the simpler version first. Okay. So let's, we have ARR of 10, 10. Let's consider this M and this N, because I want to generalize also later on. Because this M and N can be 5 or 5. This can be 10 or 20, this can be anything else. So that's why, because I want to generalize, I have taken it as M and N. And I am talking about row major first. Okay, row major form. Okay. Now, let's say I wanted to calculate the address of 5 cross 3. If you go by putting all the elements in the RAM and calculate the address, it will be very, very time consuming. Because if some time later I give you 1000 and 1000 and if I ask you the address of ARR of 533 and 237, then probably you will take 3 hours in order to calculate the address of this element only. But what is easy if you generalize by taking the small example. So let's say I have this array. I am not taking 10 rows or 10 columns. Let us take a small. Let's say this is 3 and 3 and I wanted to calculate the address of 2 cross 3. Let's say I want not 3. Let's say 2 cross 1. Let's say this is the address I wanted to calculate first. What I mean is, we have 3 rows and 3 columns. 00, 01, 02, 10, 11, 12, 20, 21, 22. And I wanted to have the address of this particular element. So this is starting from, let's say, 300. The base address will be given to you. If the question asks on address calculation, always the base address will be given. Okay. Now, in order to reach this particular element, please pay attention if you want to understand. If you want to just mug up the formula, I can write the formula directly also. So, if I wanted to reach this 2, 1, how many rows I have to leave first? I have to leave this whole row and this whole row. That is given by this particular element. Okay. In order to reach this 2, 1, I have to leave how many rows? 2 rows. If I consider my array of M and N size, and what I want to access is I and J. So in order to reach 2, 1, I have to leave I rows. So the base address plus number of rows I want to leave, and in one row how many elements I have. See, this can be, if number of rows I want to leave in one row, I can have 5 elements also, I can have 10 elements also. I am leaving how many elements here? 3 elements. And this 3, the number of elements in each row is set by M or N? N. Because in each row, how many columns are there? That is the number of elements in each row. Okay, so these many rows, and in each row I have N elements. After leaving this row and this row, in order to reach this particular element, before that element, how many elements I have to leave in that particular row? One element, that is this element only, I have to leave in that particular row. Before that element, how many rows I have left? Two rows, that is given by I. And in one row, how many elements I have? That is given by N. And after leaving these many elements, these many rows, in the row in which I have to access the element, how many elements I have to leave is given by J. That is J. And after calculating this, this is the number of elements I have to leave before reaching the particular element. Only the number of elements. But number of elements will not give you the entire picture. You have to multiply it with size of element. So multiply it with size of, let's say, integer. Now see this. Let's say this is 300. I is 2. N is 3 plus 1. And then multiply it with 4. So 300 base address. Then 6 plus 1 is 7 into 4 is 28. So the address will be 328. So after calculating this, this is the number of elements you have to leave. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So the 2 into 3 is 6 plus 1 is 7. It will give you the number of elements you have to skip before reaching to the element you wanted to access. Okay, this is the row major form. Now, if you go back to larger example which we have taken, let's say 1000 by 1000 and you wanted to access ARR of 537 and let's say 233 and the base address is let's say 1000. This is your base address. So base address plus, this is M, this is N, this is I, this is J. In row major form, what you do is, you have to skip these many rows, that is 537 into 1000, because in each row you have these many elements. And before reaching this particular element, you have to skip these many elements in that particular row. So plus 233 and multiply it by 4. After solving this, you will get the exact address of the element where you wanted to go. And no matter what is the value of this and what is the value of this, the calculation will remain same. That's why in 2D array also, if you wanted to go on a particular element, it will take constant time. Okay? Understood how we calculate the address in row major form? If we wanted to calculate the address in column major form. So in column major form, we are not skipping the rows. So here we are skipping these many rows. But in column major form, if you wanted to go to 2, 1, you have to skip these many columns. So if we calculate the address of 2, 1 only, then I have to skip one column. So base address, that is base address is 300. And after that, how many columns I have to skip? If my I and J is given, so this J will tell me how many columns I have to skip. Because in order to reach 2, 1, I have to skip this one column only, that is given by J. So instead of I, what I am doing is J. And in one column, how many elements are there? M number of elements, because M number of rows are present. So M number of elements plus after skipping these many columns, in this particular column, these many elements you have to skip, which is the number of rows before that particular element given by I. So here you add I and multiply it with by size of integer. So here 300 plus 1 into 3 plus 2 into 4. So 300 plus This is 3 plus 2 is 5. 5 into 4 is 320. The address before was 328 and now the address is 320. And now this, if you consider this 3 into 1 plus 2 is 5. So you can check here also. So before reaching this particular element, we have skipped 1 element, 2 element, 3 element, 4 element and 5 element. These 5 elements we have to skip in order to reach this particular element. So here always consider like this. In row major, if my array is ARR of M, N and we wanted to access ARR of I and J, this is you wanted to access, this is size of array. Okay, do not get confused between M or I. Okay, so the address will be ARR plus what we have done is I into N plus J into size of data type, which can be character or which can be integer or which can be anything else. And if we are talking about column major, then address will be calculated by ARR plus J into M plus I into size of data type. Okay, there will be few students who will learn this, and once the exam will come, they will get confused. They will consider this as row column major and this as row major because they have just marked up. And those who have just understood it, they will form the formula then and there only. And if you have understood it, believe me, if 3D array will come, if instead of M, N, we have M, N and O also, and you wanted to access I, J and K, then also you can calculate. Because in 3D, what you have to do is, you have to first leave that many columns. Let's say if we talk about row major, you have to leave that many rows, and in each row you have those many columns also. Because if you consider 3D array, it is stored like this. So if you leave this, let's say this row you have to leave. So in case of this row you have to leave all the columns also in this row. This whole disk will be left. That is, whole 2D array of that particular block is left. Okay, and that is given by I, that is I number of rows and then J number of columns of that particular, and then you have to reach to K. If you have understood it, then you can solve those questions also. Just try it out for 2D and 3D also. Beyond 3D, the questions do not come. But sometimes they ask for 3D also. So this is your task to understand 3D. What you have to do is, if the integer array is, let's say, of size M, N and O, and I wanted to access I, J and K, what is the address of this? Okay, that you have to do the exercise once. Okay, and one more thing before completing the lecture of today, the addresses whatever we are calculating here are logical addresses. They are not physical addresses. There are two types of addresses. One is logical address, another one is physical address. So when you do like this, integer asterisk ptr is equal to address of A, and if you try to print f percentage ul and ptr value, so this address whatever it prints, the address of A is logical address. This is not physical address. Okay, what are physical addresses? We never print physical addresses because this address get changed, okay, whenever we try to execute and compile program different types. So if you wanted to confirm it, just do one task. You just try to print the pointer address and then compile it again and then try to print it again. After 10-20 times, after doing this 10-20 times, you will see that the address which we were printing is changed. Okay, why? Because if we print the physical address or if we access the physical address, there are a lot of limitations. One of the limitation is, very, very big limitation. Let's say there is a program which wanted to access 100 to 200 address. And there is another program which wanted to access 150 to, let's say, 300. These two programs cannot run simultaneously. Why? Because there is a overlapping in between. So this is 100 to 200 and this is, let's say, 150 to 300. So there is a overlapping in between. Because of this overlapping of addresses, because at this address from 150 to 200, either P1 can remain or P2 can remain. Both cannot remain there. Okay. So that's why either P1 can run or P2 can run. Both cannot run at a time. And what problem it will make? It will make number of programs running per unit of time will decrease, which is called throughput. Throughput is what? Number of programs running per unit time. In one unit of time, how many programs are running is decreases. That's why we do not provide physical addresses. So if P1 has acquired 100 to 200, then P2 will acquire some other addresses which are free. For example, from 500 to, let's say, 650, which, let's say, this is free. So we do not stick the physical addresses with the programs or the arrays. Okay, because let's say if you have declared an array of size 100 and the address of this is 300 to, let's say, 700, for example. Okay, and after some time you have stopped working this program and some other program has taken this address and we have given the physical address to this, this array will not be allocated. If we have provided the logical address, then it will take some other addresses. That's why the logical addresses are provided, not the physical addresses. How the physical addresses are calculated, that we will study in either computer organization or in fifth semester, there is a subject called operating system, in which we will study how the logical addresses is converted into physical addresses. There is something called memory mapping unit. Memory mapping unit, which is used to convert our logical address into physical address. And the design of this we will study in some time in fourth semester or fifth semester. Okay. So I hope you have understood how to calculate the addresses of 2D arrays and 1D arrays.